guy on this aircraft. Well, now those workers are taking legal action. We'll get into it.
Well, now back to the massive manhunt in France. Two prime suspects still at large at this hour. Let's bring in Ben Collins, a veteran of the U.S. Army Special Forces and a Green Beret. He served three tours of duty in Afghanistan. So we'll draw upon your battlefield experience. Ben, what do you think is key to finding these guys?
Good morning, Jenna. So I honestly believe that when you look at the classic terrorist operation, there's a lot of logistics that's in place, right? You need to have planning meetings, money gets moved, you need to find explosives, and then you have to have the training put together to actually build the bomb or carry out the attack. So in the traditional sense, you know, that takes a lot of communication, right? A lot of emails or phone calls. And that's generally where the intelligence services or the police are able to actually find these guys when they come up, right? So through either, tracking phone calls or known entities. What we're seeing here now is a paradigm shift, in essence, where a lot of these individuals aren't having to work in a cellular format, so they've become self-radicalized. So what does that mean? They're getting a lot of their, they're recruited, they're trained, and they're launched out of basically their kitchen or their living room through the internet, through online. So it's become very difficult for the intelligence agencies and the police force, certainly in this case, I think, to really make a difference in tracking down these individuals that we're now calling lone wolves or self-radicalized.
Sure. Well, certainly a law enforcement, not only in France, but also here in the United States, the New York Police Department, for example, has struggled with the right way to infiltrate certain communities, certain Muslim communities, and find out if there's anyone bad doing anything or planning anything that could harm Americans or harm others. So, again, knowing that, if you could advise the local law enforcement to make sure they know what they need to know, what advice would you give them?
So certainly. So the NYPD actually did have a cultural or a unit that was put in place to actually infiltrate some of these organizations to find out. But it was deemed too culturally insensitive, so it was shut down. And the reality is what we see in France, this has kind of come home to roost, right? This grand socialist experiment of multiculturalism and political sensitivity. You know, they have zones in France now that are effectively no-go zones, that Muslim populations have taken over, that the police don't even go. So the police don't have sources inside. They don't have the ability to go inside.
I'm curious about that, Ben. I don't mean to interrupt you, but again, going back to your experience in Afghanistan, I'm sure there were no-go zones in Afghanistan when people said to you, oh, no, you can't go in there, Ben. You can't go in there. It's too dangerous. What would you do? And does that apply perhaps here?
It does. I mean, so you would have to develop, the most important intelligence is human intelligence. So you have to develop sources. And that takes time. And that takes the ability to actually go into these places and surreptitiously build out a contact network that can bring you intelligence. And really, especially if you look at France, there's 6.5 million Muslims, right? I mean, that's 10% of the entire population in France. It's the largest population of Muslims in Europe. They also, the last election, President Hollande won 93% of those 6.5 million. So that's a huge voting block. So, my question back would be, how motivated is the government in France, specifically the administration, going to be in making changes?
It's a big question. It's interesting, though, because it's not an entire community, right, that they're really looking at per se. These individuals that they're looking for, one of them had a criminal record, well-documented, served time. So he wasn't hiding anywhere. They knew who he was, and yet he was able to do this. How?
Well, I think if you go back to a lot of these guys in their own neighborhoods, right? I mean, in their apartment buildings, they're sitting down having their planning meetings, right? It doesn't take a whole lot of, think about what they utilized here, right? I mean, they needed planning, which they can do mostly on the internet. They were brothers, so they probably, they're in each other's environment all the time. And they needed a couple of AK-47s, which is the most prevalent weapon on the market. It's fairly easy to get in just about any city in the world. And it didn't cost that much money either. So it's very possible that they're able to do this. And my fear is we've got probably a couple of hundred, certainly Americans, a few thousand Europeans that have gone over to Syria that are now getting radicalized even more so by ISIS. And these people have Western passports, so they don't need a visa.
And you, better than anybody, can attest to the fact that battlefield experience actually matters.
It certainly does.
And that's something that we're going to certainly pay close attention to. Ben, great to see you. Thank you so much.
You as well. Thanks, Jenna.
And after police tracked down the Kouachi brothers, their next job is figuring out how the terror suspects were radicalized. For more on that, let's bring in Christopher Swift, Georgetown University National Security Studies Adjunct Professor. Is that the most important job?